The red leather jacket, its foreboding hard rock sound, and the video climax, a macho knife fight musical dance number. Beat It was a critical departure for an artist that was, up till this point, more known for bubblegum pop, disco love, and an adult fascination with Disney, giving his fans a glimpse of Michael Jackson that had the potential to be bad and dangerous. A cornerstone track of Michael Jackson's iconic album Thriller, Beat It and its accompanying musical video helped solidify Jackson as a pop music icon of the 1980s. Career-defining, it was his first creative treatment depicting black youth in the streets, as well as the first video to introduce mass choreography with his use of synchronized dancers, which became a trademark for the artist for many years to come. Part of Michael Jackson's enduring legacy was his crossover success with mass audiences, something that many Motown artists achieved, but Jackson took to a new level. Beat It proclaimed a shift for black artists from traditional R&B, soul, and funk to a resurgence in rock, and loosened the boundaries of pop music, which was key to Jackson's rise to international superstardom. This is the story behind the inspiration, production, and commercial reaction to one of pop history's most iconic musical releases, Michael Jackson's 1983 hit, Beat It. But first, if you are interested in understanding the man, the music, and the magic behind Michael Jackson, we are your dedicated channel. So hit subscribe and that bell notification as we tackle all things MJ with two new videos every week. Also, check out our store for original MJ-inspired styles, including our new beaded illustration that we created to commemorate this video. Link is in the description below. The inspiration. Beat It was produced by Jackson and Quincy Jones. Jones encouraged Jackson to include a rock song on the album, to write something like My Sharona, which was a huge hit for the Knack in 1979. Although Jackson reportedly had never previously shown an interest in the genre, but eventually was encouraged when he infused it with other dance elements. Michael Jackson understood that this song had potential to become a great crossover hit for him, later saying, "I wanted to write a song, the type of song that I would buy if I were to buy a rock song. I wanted the children to really enjoy it, the school children as well as the college students." The lyrics are about life on the streets and gang activity, expressing Jackson's dislike of violence, whilst also referring to the childhood abuse he faced at the hands of his father. Jermaine Jackson suggested the song's inspiration was the Jackson family experience of gang activity in Gary, Indiana. From our front window, we witnessed about three bad rumbles between rival gangs. Although Michael Jackson became a star at a young age and was schooled by tutors his whole life, gangs and the streets were presumably something Jackson felt very detached from for most of his life. His interpretation of two gangs coming together to rumble were likely to be based on the celluloid interpretations that he'd seen, specifically 1961's West Side Story, which used gangs as musical art. "A scene where some gang members have encroached on rival territory," is the emphatic line, "Beat It." The final lyrics mainly focuses on avoiding violence by deliberately walking away from a fight. It is based on the introspection that goes on in every individual, but mostly men, when they find themselves in a fight or lose situation. The verses can also be categorized into two voices: the good voice, which only wants peace, and the negative voice, which wants you to get aggressive. Michael Jackson was trying to reveal the twisted view of bravery and cowardice in society, to shed light on the point that sometimes being brave means to let your opponent slap you on the other cheek, even when you have the strength to beat him flat out. The production. After Jackson had written and recorded his vocals for the track, Quincy Jones called Eddie Van Halen from the rock band Van Halen to ask if he would play a guitar solo on the song. However, Eddie was initially reluctant to do the solo work on the track because he had a deal with his bandmates that they would never do any side gigs or solo projects. But because his bandmates were out of town, Eddie made the decision to go ahead and do it on the down low as a favor for Quincy, under the condition he would not be paid or credited for the work, because he didn't want other members of Van Halen to find out about it. Eddie Van Halen recalled, "Everybody from the band was out of town and I figured, who's gonna know if I play on this kid's record? I didn't want nothing. Maybe Michael will give me dance lessons someday." When Eddie arrived at Westlake Audio in West Hollywood, where the whole Thriller album was produced and recorded, he got to work right away. Although Michael Jackson was unavailable as he was working with Steven Spielberg in a recording studio down the hall doing some voice work for an E.T. side project, Sound effects guru Bruce Cannon noted that when Michael was narrating, he was very emotionally involved when he was reading the lines. At times, he almost broke into tears telling parts of the E.T. story. So, as Eddie Van Halen was busy prepping his solo in Studio B, Jackson was in a puddle of tears, lost in the world of E.T. in Studio A. According to Eddie, he had the engineer restructure the song to accommodate his solo, then blast it out in two takes. Jackson showed up after the second take and was thrilled that Eddie cared enough about the song to rework it. Eddie told CNN, "He was a musical genius with his childlike innocence. He was such a professional and such a sweetheart." Rod Temperton, who wrote the title track to Thriller, recounted a mystery blaze broke out in the control room as Eddie played his guitar solo. "Eddie was playing and the monitor speakers literally caught on fire," recalled Temperton. "The speaker caught fire and we're all thinking like, this must be really good, this solo. The technicians had to race into the control room with fire extinguishers and put it out." The entire process for Van Halen took 2 hours start to finish, and the recording of the solo itself took 20 minutes. The rest, as they say, is musical history. Later on, when his bandmates found out about it, they were the exact opposite of mad. They actually told him he was a fool for not asking for a commission when he agreed to do it. "I was a complete fool, according to the rest of the band, our manager, and everyone else. I was not used. I knew what I was doing. I don't do something unless I want to do it." Ironically, to add insult to injury, when Van Halen's 1984 album rose to number 2 on Billboard's Hot 100 for 3 weeks in March 1984, it was only held off the top position by Jackson's Thriller, which was holding the number 1 position 18 months after its initial release. The music video. Michael Jackson financed the music video to Beat It himself, at a cost of $150,000 after CBS refused to finance it. Initially, Billie Jean director Steve Barron was scheduled to direct it, with his and Jackson's original concept for the video to be set on a slave ship. However, Bob Giraldi, who later directed the infamous Pepsi commercial where Jackson's hair caught fire, he was also asked by Jackson for a video concept. At the time, Giraldi was an established commercial director, but had never directed a music video, and was only chosen by Jackson because he really liked a commercial he had directed. Bob Giraldi said in the book, I Want My MTV, "Everybody says Beat It was taken from West Side Story. It's not true. I had no idea what West Side Story was. My inspiration was the streets of Paterson, New Jersey, where I'm from. I listened to the song over and over and realized it was about all the Italian hoodlums I grew up with. Everyone trying to be tougher than they are. But really, we're all cowards at heart." Giraldi's gang concept eventually won out, as it reflected the original genesis of the song. The music video was filmed in March 1983 on Los Angeles' Skid Row, mainly on locations of East 5th Street. The second video released for the Thriller album, it was choreographed by Michael Peters, who also performed alongside Vincent Patterson, as one of the two lead dancers. The video featured 18 professional dancers and 4 breakdancers. And despite some sources claiming otherwise, Jackson was involved in creating some parts of the choreography. To add authenticity to the production, but also to foster peace between them, Jackson had the idea to cast members of rival Los Angeles street gangs, Crips and Bloods. On the first day of shooting, things got a little tense, so Giraldi had them shoot all scenes with the gang members finished that same day. The complete music video premiered on MTV on the 31st of March 1983. And became one of the most popular and memorable videos from the MTV era. Jackson became the first black artist to get regular airplay on the network when Billie Jean went into rotation. And when the video for Beat It was delivered, both videos went into hot rotation for the entire summer of 1983. The release. Beat It was released on February 14, 1983, following the successful Thriller chart performances of The Girl Is Mine and Billie Jean. Frank DeLeo, the vice president of Epic Records, convinced Jackson to release Beat It while Billie Jean was heading towards number 1. DeLeo, who later became Jackson's manager, correctly predicted that both singles would remain in the top 10 at the same time. Billie Jean remained atop the Billboard Hot 100 for 7 weeks, before being toppled by Come On Eileen, which stayed at number 1 for a single week, before Jackson reclaimed the position with Beat It for 3 weeks. Both Billie Jean and Beat It occupied the top 5 positions at the same time, a feat matched by few artists. The song and music video for Beat It proved to be a massive success critically and commercially. The American Music Awards named the short film Favorite Pop Rock Video and Favorite Soul Video, and it took home two Grammy Awards in 1984 for Best Male Rock Vocal Performance and the prestigious Record of the Year Award. Shortly after its release, Beat It was included in the National Highway Safety Commission's anti-drunk driving campaign, Drinking and Driving Can Kill a Friendship. Jackson collected an award from President Ronald Reagan at the White House in recognition for his support of the campaign. Reagan stated that Jackson was proof of what a person can accomplish through a lifestyle free of alcohol or drug abuse. People young and old respect that. And if Americans follow his example, then we can face up to the problem of drinking and driving. And we can, in Michael's words, beat it. Check out our channel for more Michael Jackson videos. And also visit our MJ store by clicking our link in the description. Thank you for watching The Detail. We'll see you next time.